night, vaccination confusion.
We've been checking the site like every day to see when it's gonna update, when we can actually book an appointment.
If you're 18 and older living in a designated COVID-19 hotspot, you may think you're able to sign up for a shot, but that might not be the case. We'll tell you why. Plus,
it's really hard to provide any sort of semblance of stability.
Parents and teachers react upon learning students won't be returning to school after the spring break. The province announcing today the move to online learning indefinitely amid the surge in COVID-19 cases. And
we've been transferring anywhere between 2 and 10 patients a day to other hospitals.
Patients being transferred hours away, thousands of surgeries canceled. The impact as Ontario grapples with record high number of patients in intensive care due to COVID-19. Good evening, I'm Kelda Yoon. Well, it's the first day of spring break for students across the province, and we learned today they will not be returning to in-class learning after the break as planned. Instead, students will be moved to online learning indefinitely. The Ford government citing high COVID-19 case counts, the threat of variants, and the strain on the hospital system as reasons for their decision to shut down schools. Our Angelina King has the details as well as reaction.
It's going to be a challenge. We were prepared for this, sort of saw the writing on the wall that, you know, this government sort of likes to make snap decisions.
Grade 6 teacher Thomas Keslick says while closing schools is the safest move, it could have been avoided.
Unfortunately, if the government had set a plan in place from September, knowing that this was going to be the case and made smaller class sizes and made distancing possible, we wouldn't have to close schools.
Premier Doug Ford says there's no timeline for when schools will open again.
We'll keep a constant eye on the data, on case numbers, hospital capacity, and ICU admissions to determine when we can get kids back in the classrooms.
Parents like Tanya Hale says that unknown is difficult.
It's really disruptive, and it's really hard to provide any sort of semblance of stability in a year of 2 years of instability.
That instability also extending to education workers trying to book their vaccines. Beginning today, special education staff across Ontario are eligible. The same goes for all staff who work or live in a hot zone in Toronto or Peel, but not all health units are ready to accommodate the bookings just yet. Some who did get an appointment have to wait until May, others are still trying.
I think at this point, I'm just gonna call every morning and try and get through.
Pathetic. Utterly inadequate.
The president of the OSSTF says ideally schools in hot zones shouldn't reopen until a few weeks after staff are vaccinated when it becomes effective, but says that could be a while.
There's no evidence whatsoever that they're going to be vaccinated within a reasonable period of time.
We need more vaccine, and as we get it, we'll be able to get into the arms of our frontline staff.
SickKids Hospital previously advocated to keep schools open for students' mental and physical health. Yesterday, the president's tune changed.
As much as it hurts me to say this, I don't think we can open schools right now. We have to just now do our part and not fail our children and do everything we can to drive down community transmission so that schools really can be the first doors to open.
While schools are closed, childcare will remain open, but before and after school programs will be closed. Angelina King, CBC News, Toronto.
Ontario is reporting 4,401 cases of COVID-19 today. That's down just slightly from yesterday's single-day record. Meanwhile, the number of ICU admissions rose, with 619 patients now in critical care. As our Chris Glover reports, thousands of surgeries are now being canceled, with doctors and nurses pleading for reinforcements.
Too many patients, too few nurses. That's the crisis at Humber River Hospital's ICU. So nurses and doctors from other units are being reassigned to intensive care.
It's pretty extraordinary when a doctor is trained all their life to do, you know, brain surgery or gallbladder surgery or chest surgery, and now is helping to turn a patient who's critically ill in the ICU on life support machines.
But ICU nursing is typically 8 months of special training.
Some of them, it has been condensed into 4 months, but it cannot be done in 2 days, and that's the situation now.
The Registered Nurses Association says last year, nurses were recalled from retirement to help in some 200 nursing homes. Back then, 700 ICU nurses were identified as potential reinforcements.
We can say are you? Can you please come back and help here? So far, the province has not requested that.
Hospitals running out of staff are also coping by transferring patients hours away.
We've been transferring anywhere between 2 and 10 patients a day to other hospitals.
The Ottawa hospital says so far at least 3 GTA COVID patients have been sent to Ottawa.
We're in the fortunate position of being on the receiving end, meaning we have more capacity.
Alarm bells rang on April 1st when 430 COVID patients were in Ontario ICUs, surpassing wave 2's high. Today, more than 600 COVID patients are in critical care.
This virus is on the attack, and it is trying desperately to bring hospitals to their knees. It's essentially cannibalizing most other health services.
A new provincial directive kicks in today, suspending thousands of elective surgeries. That happened during wave 1 and created a backlog with devastating effects.
None of these people would be forgotten.
The health minister says it's a critical step to help ICUs cope. But in Toronto, in lockdown since November, demonstrators took to the street this weekend, struggling to see the point, while doctors are struggling to explain the impact they see every day.
Whenever you're intubating somebody in their 20s or 30s, it's not a good day.
The health minister says that she expects by the end of this week, there will be 350 new ICU spaces created in Ontario. But that doesn't really address the ongoing staffing issues that so many people are talking about. So I asked Christine Elliott specifically about that at the provincial briefing today, asking if perhaps she was looking at bringing back some of those retired ICU nurses, for example, or bringing in healthcare professionals from other provinces. And the health minister would only say that she is looking at a number of ways to increase staffing levels, but no firm commitment. Chris Glover, CBC News, Toronto.
It's been a few days since the province announced they were going to start allowing people 18 and over to get vaccinated if they lived in a designated hotspot. Now, in Toronto, that means residents in more than 100 postal codes would be eligible. But there has been a lot of confusion over how this is all being rolled out. Our Greg Ross is live for us tonight in Liberty Village at a designated hotspot. And Greg, you went directly to a member of the province's vaccination task force to get some clarification.
That's right. And Kelda, it turns out this is not going to be quite as simple as many people in those high-risk postal codes may have been hoping for. In fact, I've been talking to a lot of people here in Liberty Village where I am right now, and a lot of them, when they found out last week that they were going to be able to get vaccinated, they went online, they started looking for information, they started trying to book appointments, but there was no information and there were no appointments to book. And as you said, just a lot of confusion.
We've been checking the site like every day to see when it's going to update, when we can actually book an appointment.
Kyle O'Meara and Caitlin Irving aren't the only ones who have been anxiously trying to book an appointment since learning they live in a high-risk area.
I don't feel like there's any clear communication as to where those clinics are, the dates, how to sign up, nothing like that.
I feel like there's maybe not as much information, it's not as clear as it maybe needs to be.
Not only has there not been any information, there's no plan to provide any, at least not publicly.
I wish there was more clarity at the time of the announcement.
Dr. Isaac Bogosh is with Ontario's Vaccine Task Force. He says mobile and pop-up clinics will be coming to hotspots, but he says they're going to be strategically located in places where they can target the people at the highest risk.
So, for example, they'll be situated in the community centers or in a house of worship or in front of high-density housing or at a business or a factory or a place of work where there's a lot of people working. If it's coming to a place of work, people at that place of work will be notified. If it's going to a community center, members of that community will be notified.
There was a pop-up clinic in Thorncliffe Park over the weekend. More than 1,000 people were able to be vaccinated. Some waited in line for hours. No one was turned away as long as they had ID to prove they lived in the area.
If you're in that postal code and you're 18 years of age, you're certainly eligible. But the goal is to really reduce any barriers and all barriers to vaccination, especially for people that may not be able to make it out to mass vaccine sites.
People between the ages of 18 and 49 who would prefer to book an appointment and avoid long lineups are going to have to be patient because it's going to be a while.
I understand that. I understand like focusing on high-risk individuals, frontline workers first. So I get that.
We're lucky enough to be able to like work from home and, you know, have masks readily available and whatnot.
And we should also point out that we simply just don't have the capacity to vaccinate everybody over the age of 18 en masse right now. And that's because millions of vaccines that have been promised to Canada still have not been delivered. So we have to wait for those vaccines to get here before we can really open it up to a wider range of people, Kelda.
Thanks, Greg. That's our Greg Ross reporting live for us tonight. Let's go to our meteorologist, Colette Kennedy, now with a first look at the forecast. And Colette, one of those gloomier days.
Yeah, that's right, Kelda. It was a little gloomier. You know, if you want to have the days like we had last week where it's so enjoyable with mild temperatures, well, hey, we need that rainfall to make everything look green and pretty so we can enjoy it on the dry, sunnier days. So that's what's happening. We're just into a more active pattern right now. So off and on we get into these kind of showers. And overnight tonight, it's really just some of this drizzle, drier in nature than it was earlier, but some drizzle still around and some patchy fog too. So making for some reduced visibility on the roads. If you do need to be out there, if you are a shift worker, I always like to mention try and allow some extra time for yourself so you keep yourself safe there. Now into the morning, we will see more spotty showers developing. And then towards the afternoon, it's going to be slow, but watch that line as the clouds will clear from west to east. So we'll get some sunshine coming back in, but then a return in the evening of showers, especially to the north of the GTA. So that's what we'll be watching. Sunnier skies, though, through the afternoon hours into southwestern Ontario. Toronto, 7 degrees tomorrow, 13 degrees with the sun coming in the afternoon.
Thanks, Colette.
This third wave is likely going to be the worst that we have seen.
Coming up, Toronto is bracing for as many as 2,500 new cases of COVID-19 per day by the end of the month. We'll have more on the stark projection after the break. Welcome back. A new report from Toronto's Medical Officer of Health says the city is on track to see 2,500 new daily cases of COVID-19 by the end of the month. Ali Shiasan has more on this latest data.
I anticipate that...
In the city's Board of Health briefing, we heard trends are again headed in the wrong direction.
Looking at the top part of the graph, as you can see here, if transmission stays the same at the current level that it is now, we can actually expect to see over 2,500 daily cases or about 165,000 cumulative cases by the end of April.
To put that into perspective,
in our previous wave two, the highest daily number of reported cases was 1,642.
The data suggests
this third wave is likely going to be the worst that we have seen. This is due to increased transmission and increased severity associated with that B.1.1.7 variant of concern, which is now the dominant strain.
Even with the variants of concern, the most effective way to break the chains of transmission is through physical distancing. The most extreme form of doing that is staying home, which not everyone can do. And that too is present in the data.
What we have seen recently is reduced mobility overall in the city, but not equally experienced in all parts of the city.
This is a map of mobility data derived from anonymous cell phone usage. The neighborhoods in blue indicate more people staying in and not moving around much. A lot of these postal codes would be considered more affluent. But then have a look at the northwest corner of the map, where more movement is indicated. This is also where many essential workers live, where staying at home is a lot harder. This is a pattern that hasn't changed, while the strength of the virus has. According to the city data, the variants have resulted in 91% more deaths and a 36% increase in hospitalizations.
I think this week is a real moment of truth.
And yet, no new restrictions have been announced.
I think at the end of the day, what we have to do for the moment is focus on the measures we have in place.
The city's top officials say worst-case scenarios will be reached if transmission rates don't change and if momentum slows on the vaccination front.
This pandemic will only end when the majority of us are vaccinated. I think we can do better than those projections would suggest.
Ali Chiasson, CBC News, Toronto.
A Toronto city councillor wants to formally allow alcohol consumption in parks.
We know that cities around the world and here in Canada, like Montreal, allow for responsible adults to have a drink in a park, and that has not been a concern for them. In fact, we still have rules ensuring that people behave well, that we don't have drunken disorderly behavior. People still need to adhere to provincial rules. But ultimately, if you look around the world, most of them are looking at Toronto asking, you know, are they allowing Sunday shopping yet? Like, what's going on there? Why wouldn't they allow responsible adults to be able to get outside?
Councillor Josh Matlow is pushing for a pilot project to allow having alcoholic drinks, but not hard liquor, in public parks and beaches, and also to ensure that those spaces have a bathroom facility. The councillor argues it is safer and better for us to be outdoors where the risk of transmission is far less. The pilot would only run from May 21st to October 21st. And Porter Airlines is once again pushing back its tentative restart date. It now hopes to be back in the air in just over 2 months. It was previously aiming for May, but the airline now says it hopes to resume flights on June 21st. Porter offers short-haul flights across Canada and the U.S. It has not flown since March 2020.
Back to Suzuki again. Tries again. Fires. Scores! Suzuki on the power play, and it's 2-0 Montreal.
The Leafs taking on the Habs tonight in Montreal, looking for their seventh straight win. The Habs took a two-goal lead in the first period, but Toronto answered back in the second, tying things up with a pair of goals by Austin Matthews and John Tavares. But the Habs would add one more goal in the second and an empty netter in the third to take this one 4-2.
On the ground, that'll score a run.
And the Jays kicking off their series against the Yankees in Dunedin, Florida. Toronto took an early lead in this game, scoring a run in the first inning, but the Yankees came back in the fifth, scoring two runs to take the lead. They would add another in the eighth, and that's all it took. The Yankees win this one 3-1. Well, your 7-day forecast is coming up after the break. Plus, this isn't your mother's mahjong.
Creating this required a lot of work, and you know we're doing this as a passion project.
How an Oakville couple reimagined the traditional game to get their families to connect. That's coming up next.
The weather is brought to you by Trane, the most reliable heating and cooling brand. We test, so it runs. It's hard to stop a train.
Foggy patches this evening and remaining foggy overnight with some drizzle as we head into the morning. Currently 8 degrees downtown. Let's go back to Colette now with a look at your extended forecast. And Colette, some April showers are to be expected. And as you said, we need some of that rain. We saw that today, and there's more to come this week.
Yeah, and that's right. And we all know the saying, it brings the May flowers. But, you know, it brings the April flowers, too, because we've been seeing those crocuses kind of popping up. And I've been watching my garden get greener and greener. So nice to see. We do have some showers. Temperatures are just closer to seasonal. But even in most cases, still a couple of degrees above. They're just not as extreme. Now, look at these. These are the daytime highs. It's because yesterday we were up to 17. So this was just after midnight. It's 1 o'clock in the morning. We still had some of that warmth. And then it actually fell off as we went towards 7 a.m. 8 degrees. In fact, everyone was a single digit except for London at that point, where you had 10 degrees. And then we kind of came back, especially in southwestern Ontario and especially in extreme eastern Ontario. Look at Ottawa's temperature there. Something there, not quite like the others. Where you could get out of the cloud cover, weren't into some of this instability. That's where things change. So what we have tonight is some of this drizzle and the fog in certain areas. It'll be a little bit heavier. That lingers into tomorrow morning, but we'll also see a few showers that develop and come through in the morning hour. So yeah, some wet roads for the morning commute. But you see that cloud line move across the western end of Lake Ontario and allow the sun to be coming in. There'll be sun prior to that southwestern Ontario, and in fact your temperatures are going to be quite lovely there, but you see some of that cloud cover tracking and pushing towards the east, and a return in the evening of getting some showers, especially in the cottage country or just to the north of, say, the 407 through there. But if we look ahead, Wednesday's kind of different in that we should have sun to begin, and then it's later in the day the showers and some heavier rains will push through. So the beginning part of your day is looking pretty good for that day. But it's an active pattern, so it's just going to keep coming at you. I'll do my best to let you know kind of when, so you can find the dry times to get outside too. Overnight tonight, 6 degrees with that clearing occurring through the overnight hours. You will be getting the clearing happening, and that allows for this to happen tomorrow afternoon. Now, those winds will pick up from the southwest, 17 Windsor for your high. And around the Golden Horseshoe, there it is, that into the morning, there will be some areas where you might see that visibility a little bit trickier on the roadways, but into the afternoon, especially where we break out of that cloud deck, then we would see the temperatures going into the mid-teens, where they will be on Wednesday till the rain showers move in later. It's a steadier rain, Kelda, as we get into Thursday, and that's when the temperature kind of drops back to seasonal for this time of year.
Okay. Thanks so much, Colette. Finally tonight, what started as a way to find something in common between their grandmothers turned into a game everyone can enjoy. We meet the Oakville couple that reimagined the game of Mahjong to help their families connect. And that's how Not Your Ma's Jong was created. Check it out.
So many prototypes. Creating this required a lot of work, and you know, we're doing this as a passion project. The idea for Not Your Mahjong came about in 2018 when we were pregnant with our first daughter. We knew that she was going to grow up both part Jewish, Hungarian, Italian, and also half Chinese. So we wanted to celebrate that in a way by incorporating parts of our family story into a game.
Great. Yeah, Not Your Mahjong is a 3-4 player game. The objective is to try to match three sets of three cards across the different suits that we have, plus a pair. And that's how you went around.
I remember Adam cutting out like index cards and figuring out the sizing. How could you fit 10 cards in your hand comfortably? So we were looking at regular card sizes or bridge card sizes.
And we also, of course, had to make sure that the gameplay was fun. So we spent a lot of time on the mechanics of it. Mahjong is traditionally 144 tiles or so, depending on the version. And we got the card game down to 75 different cards. So really making sure that probabilities made sense, that the stealing rules were fast-paced and fierce, as we like to say, and that people would have a lot of fun with it. And we wanted to make the illustrations on the cards really fun. So they're centered around memories of our grandmothers. We imagined also a set where maybe they had met earlier in life and they lived closer together and they were friends. So what kind of fun things could they do? You know, playing bingo together, doing Tai Chi in the park.
My favorite one is the red one. The fortune kitty is pretty iconic, and a lot of Asian families will have a version of a fortune kitty sitting in their home somewhere.
I love the love card. Just that image of growing up and grandma's just getting in your face, trying to give you lots of kisses. And I think that's really the message of Not Your Mahjong, to celebrate your culture, your traditions, and really be proud of those. And also to call your grandma if you still have the opportunity. I'm sure she'd love to hear from you.
And that's our show for you tonight. Thank you so much for watching. And it's the first night of Ramadan, so we want to wish a blessed Ramadan to all those who are observing. Have a great night, everyone.